गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज डॉक्टर तेजल चौधरी, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर एट जीएमसी सूरत गुजरात. टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट एनेस्थेटिक एजेंट्स. सो वी ऑल नो देर आर वेरियस एनेस्थेटिक एजेंट्स, सम ओल्डर, सम वेंट ऑब्सोलीट, एंड देर आर मेनी रीसेंट वंस which have different properties of their own, and they are being preferred according to the patient's condition, patient's comorbid conditions, cost effectiveness, and its effects on various organ systems. So today we will get a brief regarding various anesthetic agents, be it an intravenous agent or it can be an inhalation agent. So today we will focus on discussing about anesthetic agents. First, let's get a brief of what an word anesthesia means. Anesthesia is invented from a Greek word aesthesia. As you all know, what aesthesia in Greek means is feelings, any kind of feelings, whether it be a pain sensation or feeling of sensation, any feelings, it's known as aesthesia. And anesthesia is loss of feeling. So when there's no feeling, no pain, then it is anesthesia. So there are various drugs which help in giving anesthesia. So talking about anesthesia, it has three parts. When we start up with anesthesia and reach up to the level, well, there is a loss of consciousness and there is a plane of surgical anesthesia. It is known as induction of anesthesia. We induce the patient. That means we give an ample amount of drugs in various forms that will blunt consciousness, all the reflexes, according to the surgical requirement, according to the sedation level that we required, say in remote places. Then we maintain that particular anesthesia, which is the second phase of anesthesia, is also known as maintenance of anesthesia. We continue with some of the drugs, the same that was used in induction dose, but in a maintenance dose. And we may add some other additives and then continue or maintain the anesthesia, is known as maintenance of anesthesia. And then after maintenance, when it is required, surgery ends or the procedure ends or the sedation ends, we bring back the patient to his original state in terms of consciousness, reflexes and respiration. And that is known as recovery or emergence from anesthesia. So again, it is a reversible loss of consciousness, also known as anesthesia. And what are the other components of it? Analgesia. Amnesia, that means loss of memory. No one will like to remember the memory during surgical. So we need a particular depth of anesthesia so that the patient doesn't remember perioperative events which are noxious in terms of pain and memories. Also to these we add muscle relaxation so that the patient doesn't move during any procedure. So these are the components of anesthesia, and in every component there are various drugs. Some drug act like a relaxation. Some induction agent, if given in a higher dose, can also give relaxation. So it's a form of multimodal treatment which leads to a balanced anesthesia. What is balanced anesthesia? When you have all the components in balance. You have pain control, you have amnesia, you have loss of anxiety, you have adequate relaxation, and when everything is in balance, it is known as balanced anesthesia. Now talking about history, when the first induction agent, that is ether, was invented, where so-called anesthesia branch was invented, and here you can see tooth extraction was performed under ether anesthesia. Before that, all the surgical procedures were very painful, and there was an agony lying along with the surgical procedures. And when W.T.G. Morton, that is William Thomas Green Morton, first invented ether, and he first publicly demonstrated the use of ether for a surgical procedure. This happened in Massachusetts General Hospital, where it went famous, and ether was then subsequently started in use, its use in surgical anesthesia. W.T.G. Morton, as we all know, also well known as father of anesthesia. And then after ether, then subsequently another component, that is chloroform, came in 1847 around, and then it was very well used in along with ether, in substitute of ether. Then after that, other inhalation agents were invented, say for cyclopropan, which came in invention at in 1929, which lasted for and was clinically used for 30 more years. Just because ether and chloroforms have their own noxious effects, chloroform was quite cardiac depressant and hepatotoxic, but ether, as we all know, has noxious post-op nausea and vomiting. So due to some noxious effects of its their own, cyclopropane came in action and was prevalent for almost 30 years. But again, when all gadgets and modern equipments came in use, and just because cyclopropane was an inflammable drug, methoxyfluorine, which was subsequently invented, take over the cyclopropane. But again, methoxyfluorine has its own drawback of nephrotoxicity. And subsequently, many more inhalation agents came into action. We'll discuss about them in the upcoming discussions. Now, let's talk about the basics of anesthesia, that is, stages of anesthesia. Let's talk about in what stage a plane of anesthesia is required, say it in surgery or in sedation. Mr. Goodell has stated these four stages of anesthesia, where when you exclusively give an agent, say for Goodell gave ether and no other other components, say as anticholinergic or any other additive agents, only when you give an ether and observe the progress by gradually increasing the dose of ether, drops for ether in these terms. Initially, there is a loss of consciousness. It is known as stage of analgesia. Then there comes the stage of excitement, also known as stage of delirium, where there are chances of sympathetic stimulation. It is technically also called as lighter plane of anesthesia, where in which this plane, if you give some noxious pain stimuli, the patient can have laryngospasm, bronchospasm. So practically, we prefer giving stage 3 of anesthesia, and that is surgical anesthesia, in which all the reflexes gradually get abolished. There are no chances of spasm because there is somewhat respiratory paralysis according to the dose of and depth of anesthesia. And then you don't have papillary reflex, you don't have painful noxious stimuli reflex, and that is surgical anesthesia. We take all the patients to that particular anesthesia. And then if the higher dose is given in this stage, patient might turn to medullary paralysis, which is hazardous. So you have to maintain the plane of surgical anesthesia. It's like riding an aeroplane, and when you induce a patient, you start up the aeroplane, and then you maintain a plane of anesthesia, and that is surgical anesthesia, so that patient doesn't come to stage 2, where patient can get sympathetic stimulation and tetanus, or not in stage 4, where you can have respiratory paralysis, which can worsen the outcome and emergence of anesthesia. And stage 5 is death, where there is no recovery to the reversal of anesthesia. So these days, these stages are somewhat merged. We go to the surgical anesthesia directly because our other additive agents like anticholinergics, opioids, which are all additives and also are blunting the sympathetic response, which doesn't manifest in typical staging of anesthesia, just like the Goodell noted during ether anesthesia. Now, talking about general anesthesia, as we all know, general anesthesia is loss of consciousness and reflexes, which is again a reversible state. Okay, so what are other type of anesthesia? Are regional anesthesia and local anesthesia. Local anesthesia is what? In which you numb a particular area of the part of the body. Say if you have a small abscess and you have to do an IND, you particularly numb that area and put an incision and drainage. Where you use some local anesthetic or local administration of some anesthetic, it is known as local anesthesia. What is regional anesthesia is when you particularly block nerve roots or nerve plexus or say digital nerves to block particular organ, which is say be it a finger, hand or a leg, or spinal anesthesia. Today we'll talk about general anesthesia. General anesthesia has many components with it. It decreases anxiety. One, it gives sedation and loss of consciousness. There is no relaxation. Just because we supplement either with a muscle relaxation or we give an ample amount of induction agents or anesthetic agents to suppress the relaxation, or in a deep sleep when the muscle is relaxed, when you have a suppression of undesirable reflexes, and when you have adequate analgesia. Again, not any single agent can provide all these components of general anesthesia. So, say if you use IV ketamine, it has a potent analgesic effect. But if you use thiopental sodium, it is antanalgesic. So, you will have to supplement an analgesic along with thiopental. According to the surgical requirement also, you have to supplement the analgesics and muscle relaxants. So again, there is not a single agent which fulfills all the aims of general anesthesia, and we approach a multimodal treatment. Talking about inhalation anesthesia, as I already told, there were agents which are nowadays obsolete like chloroform, methoxyfluran due to its own noxious effects. These days, desfluran, sevofluran, isofluran, halothane, nitrous oxide are widely prevalent according to the patient's comorbid condition and availability of the inhalation agent. Enfluran is also in use in many institutes. It has its own color coding as it is shown in. These are available in various bottles. Say for it has its own international color coding systems, like yellow for sevofluran, purple for isofluran, and so on. Nitrous oxide, halothane, isofluran, desfluran, and sevofluran. These are the agents we practically use in our institute. And enfluran is also used in clinical practice these days. Now, talking about how it acts and how it is delivered. As you can see, there is an anesthesia machine here. When you pour that bottle of liquid into a vaporizer, an inhalation induction agents come in the form of liquid. When you pour it into a vaporizer, there are vapors which are formed, which are traveled to the alveoli through anesthetic breathing circuits. These are traveled by help of agents like oxygen, air, or nitrous oxide, whichever is started along with the inhalation agent. They travel to the alveoli. From alveoli, it reaches to the brain via systemic circulation. From alveolar capillaries to the brain circulation, and then it reaches to the brain to make its action. So again, that as I already told you, oxygen is bubbled in volatile anesthetic agent. Vapor is formed through the machine. It is delivered to the lungs. It diffuses through the alveolar capillary membrane, goes to the blood, and acts on brain. So this is what anesthetic agent doesn't directly act on brain, but it has to pass through a series of events. So there are various factors at each level that can determine the effect of inhalation agent to the brain. Okay, so talking about MAC is a minimum alveolar concentration. When you give a single inhalation agent and assume that 50 patient doesn't respond to a painful noxious stimuli, be it a surgical incision, it is the particular MAC of that inhalation agent. Okay, so if you give only ether and you assume that 50% has not reached not moved to the painful surgical stimuli, that is the minimum alveolar concentration of inhaled anesthetic. So generally, if it is 1.2 to 1.3 mag, it achieves the 90 to 95% patients not moving to noxious surgical stimuli. So if we consider desfluran mag is 6, so we have to keep the diode concentration according to the mag, 1.2 to 1.3 mag, which is required for a surgical anesthesia, to not move 95% patients to the noxious stimuli. So mag also helps in determining the potency of, or help in knowing the potency of various agents, like nitrous oxide mag is 105, whereas halothane mag is 0.75. So just because nitrous oxide's mag is 105, it is a weak agent. It alone is not sufficient to have an adequate surgical anesthesia. So you need to have another inhalation agent along with nitrous oxide. Okay, so likewise, desfluran mag is 6, sevofluran mag is 2, isofluran is 1.16, enfluran is 1.68, and again halothane is 0.75. Just now we'll talk about oil gas partition coefficient and blood gas partition coefficient. These two are very important for pharmacokinetics and dynamics of inhalation agent. Oil gas and blood gas. Just as I have told you that anesthetic agent which is coming to the alveolar capillaries goes to the brain. So if you have a high blood gas coefficient, that is, what is high blood gas coefficient is? That means concentration of anesthetic agent is high in blood and less in gas. So it will not stay. It will stay more in blood and less concentration will go to the brain. And high blood gas coefficient will have delayed effect or delayed onset of action. Likewise, nitrous oxide, which has high blood gas partition coefficient, so it takes a while to act to the brain. Whereas desfluran has low blood gas partition coefficient, so it takes earlier to induce the patient. So blood gas coefficient helps to determine the onset of induction and also the recovery. Oil gas partition coefficient indicates that whatever anesthetic agent that is there in the fat tissues, in adipose tissues, say in obese patients, if the oil gas partition coefficient of the anesthetic agent is high, in obese patients it will take a while to come out from the oil to the alveolar gas which needs for emergence. So a patient induction agent with high oil gas partition coefficient will have delayed recovery than an induction agent which has low oil gas partition coefficient. So you're getting me, right? So this is what affects the induction and recovery of anesthetic agent. Now let's talk about nitrous oxide. Very well known as a laughing gas. It is the only inorganic anesthetic gas in clinical use. It is colorless and odorless. Again, it is not inflammable or explosive just like chloroform. It's non-inflammable and it is gaseous form in room temperature, whereas it is in liquid form under pressure. As you can see in the pictures, these are nitrous oxide cylinders. Its international color coding is blue. So the knob of flow meters, the pipeline system, the cylinders, everything will be covered blue for easy identification of nitrous oxide cylinders. Again, it is inexpensive, so can be very well used in clinical use, and also it helps to potentiate the action of other anesthetic agents. So clinically, it will decrease the MAC of other anesthetic agents, decrease the requirement of other anesthetic agents, can be of use with other agents. Again, it is in liquid form in cylinders, but when it is delivered, it comes in room temperature. It will form a gaseous form, which is then delivered to the alveoli in a vapor form. Now, talking about nitrous oxide, so it has less sympathetic nervous system stimulation on higher potency. Otherwise, it is hardly somewhat depression of myocardial contractility, and there is a slight increase in blood pressure, heart rate, and cardiac output, which is clinically quite insignificant at many times, but again it has a significant diffusion hypoxia. Nitrous oxide has its property wherein when it traverses through membrane, it 20 times more shift out than an oxygen molecule to come in. So, which leads to diffusion hypoxia, especially when you use nitrous oxide as an induction agent during anesthesia, and when you switch off the nitrous oxide or you cut off the nitrous oxide and nitrous oxide diffuses out to the alveoli, there are chances of hypoxia due to more diffusion of out and leading to taking of oxygen, lesser oxygen to the alveolar level or alveolar arterial level, leading to diffusion hypoxia due to its property. So this is to be taken care of during clinical by adequate oxygenation even after switching off the nitrous oxide, or switching off the nitrous oxide 3 to 4 minutes before switching off the oxygen or putting the patient to the room air. So this is to be taken care of during practice. Again, it increases cerebral blood flow, then there is slight increase in ICP, but not to that significant level. It has also concentrating effect, which I already told you that it increases the potency of other anesthetic agents. Just as because the property of nitrous oxide has a tendency to expand the closed spaces. Just as in if you have a tympanic membrane grafting, and when you put graft onto the middle ear in the surgery, mastoid surgery, and when you switch off the nitrous oxide, it can displace the graft, because when a closed space is formed, it has a tendency to expand that closed space because of its property, because it diffuses out faster. 20 molecules of nitrous oxide diffuses out faster when one molecule of nitrogen comes in. So when there is an emboli, it can expand. So it is absolutely contraindicated in these cases. When there is a pneumothorax, it can lead to worsening of pneumothorax. When there is an intestinal obstruction, it can expand the obstruction. And especially when there is an air in the syphilis, when there is pneumosyphilis, it is avoided. Okay, so anything that is a closed cavity, be it an air embolism, pneumothorax, pneumoencephalus, or a surgical procedure which creates a closed space like tympanic membrane grafting, you should avoid nitrous oxide. Talking about halothane, halothane was invented after this isoflurane, and which came into action, but it has a red color coding. You can see the vaporizer on the left side. This is a vaporizer which produces vapors out of the liquid which is there in the bottle to get delivered through the anesthetic breathing circuit to the alveoli. Now, talking about halothane, it is a halogenated alkene. Again, it is non-inflammable and non-explosive. It is less expensive. It has a MAC value of 0.75, means it's highly potent, and it's volatile. It is light sensitive, so it is available in an amber colored bottle. Just because it is a light sensitive agent, it has a pleasant odor and it is non-irritant. So when you induce the patient with halothane through inhalation anesthesia, it is quite pleasant and non-irritant. It has a dose-dependent action on all organ system. It has dose-dependent depression of BP and myocardial depression. It is a specific coronary artery dilator. Especially, it has a property of epinephrine sensitivity. When you use with other sympathomimetic agents like adrenaline, it can increase the epinephrine sensitivity, which can lead to arrhythmias and hazardous cardiac activity. So you have to be cautious while using halothane with epinephrine or adrenaline. You can decrease the MAC of halothane. With lesser MAC, there are less chances of epinephrine sensitivity. Also, with other inhalation agents, there are some epinephrine sensitivity reactions found when you decrease or increase the MAC value of every agent. So, whenever there is an infiltrate of adrenaline is going on, you have to be cautious and decrease the amount of MAC, or if feasible, you can shut off the halothane and continue it when the injection is being over. Now, it is again a potent bronchodilator. It increases cerebral blood flow and it also relaxes skeletal muscle, and it has a property of potentiating non-depolarizing neuromuscular blocking agents like vecuronium and rocuronium. It decreases renal blood flow and hepatic blood flow. It has a property of hepatotoxicity. It can cause type 1, type 2 hepatotoxicity. So whenever there is a liver dysfunction, you have to avoid giving halothane, especially when with a previous history of halothane exposure and a said or documented liver dysfunction, then you have to preferably avoid halothane. Also, in very hypovolemic patient with severe cardiac diseases, just because it has some myocardial depressant activity and decreasing blood pressure, so you have to avoid with severe hypovolemic patient with severe cardiac diseases. Now, talking about enfluran, it has a MAC of 1.68, it has a sweet and ethereal odor, and it is a cardiovascular depressant, but it has a tendency to activate the epileptic foci. So it is contraindicated in epileptic patients, and its fluoride content has toxic effect on renal system and can lead to renal failure on prolonged exposure. So these effects led to development of the isomer of enfluran, and that is isofluran. So isofluran is in use in recent practice, and it is again a non-flammable volatile with a pungent smell. So for inhalation, it is a bit irritant for inhalation induction. It has minimum cardiac depressant effect. But if you increase the MAC suddenly, it can increase the heart rate and blood pressure and can lead to coronary steel phenomenon, where underperfused areas get perfused due to vasodilatation of the coronary arteries and can lead to detrimental effect. So, always ensure that any inhalation agent, you titrate and increase the MAC gradually only, because any inhalation agent, if you suddenly increase the MAC to a particular level, there will be increase in heart rate and blood pressure. So, again, cerebral system, it increases the blood flow of cerebral circulation only if you increase the MAC from 1. Less than 1 MAC, it has a minimal effect on the cerebral blood flow. And in fact, it's a preferable for neurosurgeries because it has less effect to the cerebral circulation and does not raise ICT, which is preferable for neurosurgery and also in the cardiac surgery. Okay. So, within acceptable MAC, it has minimal effects on cardiac and neurosystem. It decreases renal blood flow and hepatic blood flow to some extent. Again, as I already told you, there is no such contraindication to the use of isofluran. But patient with severe hypovolemia who can't tolerate the vasodilating effects, you should avoid. And within less than 1 MAC, there are lesser effects on all the systems. So you can very well use. Desfluran, when came in action in say 1996, has become a drug of choice in many institutes and many surgical procedures, especially the short duration procedures and daycare surgeries, because it has a less blood gas partition coefficient, so faster induction and faster recovery, and a good MAC of 6%, and its structure is almost similar to isofluran, and again it has a pungent smell, so it is not induction of choice for induction for inhalation, But again, it is a good choice for maintenance. It has low oil gas partition coefficient, so recovery is also faster. Again, it is 50% less time than isofluran, so that's why it is very well used these days. Moreover, it is least hepatic metabolism or least renal elimination, so it is preferable in many of the comorbid conditions also. Talking about cardiovascular system, again, if you increase the MAC very rapidly, it will increase the heart rate and blood pressure. But you titrate it gradually, then it has minimal effect on the cardiovascular system and a preferred agent for cardiac diseases, especially if you allow to the lesser MAC. Respiratory system, just as I have told you, it's a pungent smell, so it's very irritant to the airway, can cause coughing and spasm at times. So, not a preferred choice for inhalation induction. Again, preferably to be avoided in asthmatics. It increases the cerebral blood flow, it relaxes the skeletal muscles, and renal and hepatic system toxicity has not been documented so far till date, since 1996. So again, it has minimal metabolism in the system. So it's a preferred drug in many comorbid conditions, for especially the hepatic and renal surgeries. And again, the day case surgeries, because it has faster induction and faster recovery. It's contraindicated in malignant hypothermia, raised ICT, and severe hypovolemia, which can't tolerate induction agents higher than particular MAC. Talking about sevoflurane, it is non-pungent, so it is very well preferred for inhalation inductions, especially in children who are quite whose intravenous injections are most of the times not feasible. In these cases, induction with inhalation agents is preferred with sevoflurane, just because it's non-irritant and non-pungent. So, in pediatric population, sevoflurane is prevalent. It has mild cardiac depression activity and it has insignificant QT interval prolongation. But again, to a particular MAC, has minimal effect. It decreases respiratory rate and again it has chances of bronchospasm to be taken in mind. And then it increases cerebral blood flow and ICP. In again malignant hyperthermia, sevoflurane is avoided. Now these was about induction agents. Now for brainstorming, let's have a quick MCQ. You can guess the answer. When a female patient, 43-year-old, came to ER with a history of fall from second floor with a complaint of neck pain, chest pain, on examination, patient revealed vertebral fracture and has a mild pneumothorax in chest x-ray. Patient needs anesthesia. What can be the agent and what is to be avoided? So as you can see, halothane, nitrous oxide, sevoflurane, isoflurane. Now talking about pneumothorax, as I already told you, what can be the avoided agent is nitrous oxide. Yes, nitrous oxide has tendency to worsen the pneumothorax. It has tendency to enhance the closed space. So nitrous oxide is to be avoided in this case, to be taken in mind. Okay, so this was about inhalation agents. Now we'll take a brief of intravenous anesthetic agents. So this is a long list of an ideal intravenous agent. It is supposed to be rapid in onset and offset. It has to have some analgesic effect, anti-emesis. It should not give a pain on injection. Not non-toxic to all organs. No excitation or emergence phenomenon. It is meant to have long shelf life and it should not have any hypersensitivity reactions. So an ideal anesthetic agent to be given intravenously is supposed to have all these features. But again, not a single agent can have all the features. So according to the patient's need, you have to choose the induction agent according to its property. Now let's talk about anesthetic agents. So when you talk about barbiturate agents, so thiopentone sodium and methohexitone are barbiturate anesthetic agents. Non-barbiturate anesthetic agents are ketamine, etomidate, benzodiazepines and propofol. This is thiopentone sodium. It is available in a yellow amorphous powder. It is to be diluted up to with normal saline or water with up to 2.5% solution to have its action. It is very highly alkaline, so it is not to be diluted with Ringer lactate. It is highly lipid soluble, and once diluted, it can be stored up to 48 hours. Again, it is an ultra short acting barbiturate. Its arm brain circulation is 15 seconds. Arm brain circulation means if you give an IV agent, it reaches the brain and gives its action within 15 seconds. It has a duration of 10 to 15 minutes. But, okay, so this is the dose of per kg. And the maintenance dose is 50 to 100 milligram every 10 to 12 minutes. As you can see, this is the GABA receptor. It acts on the GABA receptor, stimulates the GABA receptor. GABA receptor is an inhibitory neurotransmitter in CNS. When GABA receptor is activated, the chloride conduction is increased, which leads to inhibitory action and CNS depression. So, thiopentone sodium acts on GABA receptor. It is used for induction, maintenance, and it has some anti-epileptic action. It also decreases ICP. It is contraindicated in airway obstruction. It is absolutely contraindicated in porphyria and with a previous history of histamine hypersensitivity, because it's a sulfa drug. So better to avoid if once an allergy or reaction has occurred. So it can cause laryngospasm, bronchospasm, especially it is if given in intra-arterial route, it can cause severe vasospasm, pain and gangrene. So your intravenous access should be adequate to avoid injection into artery, because it can lead to gangrene of the limb if accidental intra-arterial injection occurs. So this is the ketamine. Ketamine, as you can see, it has dissociative anesthesia. Its action is dissociative anesthesia. Thalamocortical and limbic system, it dissociates the systems and leads to analgesia, cardiac stimulant action, sympathomimetic action and bronchodilator action. But chances of emergence delirium is high. So we generally supplement with benzodiazepine or opioids to prevent emergence delirium for ketamine. Okay. Again, it has a tendency to increase the secretions and bronchodilation. So we generally give anticholinergics to decrease the secretions to combat the effect of high secretion. It acts through the NMDA receptor and it antagonizes the receptor to induce dissociative anesthesia. Its dose is 0.5 to 2 mg per kg. It can also be given in IM, intramuscular route, especially in the children, to induce to 4 to 6 mg per kg. It can be used as preemptive analgesic in the dose of 0.15 to 0.25 mg per kg. What is preemptive analgesia is, before noxious stimuli is given and pain occurs, you give before that. That is known as preemptive analgesia. It is said that when you give a preemptive analgesia instead of routine analgesia before stimuli, then there is chances of decreased sensitization of pain to the stimuli. Okay, so it can be also given for sedation. Okay, so its duration of action is 10 to 20 minutes. It is again a good agent of choice because it has an analgesic property. Whereas thiopentone is antanalgesic, you have to supplement analgesic with thiopentone. But ketamine has a good analgesic effect. So it is a very good agent of choice for burns, dressing, incision and drainage, short procedures, ischemic limb pain, especially in shock, because it has a tendency to increase sympathetic activity. So hemodynamically compromised patient, shock, etc. It has good effect, does not worsen the hemodynamics, especially in remote places, just because ketamine has a tendency to preserve the reflexes, which prevents subjects to aspirate or depressor. So in remote places where you don't have adequate gadgets to put patients on ventilator and so, in remote places to give sedation, say in MRI and all, it's very preferable. Again, in MRI, the agent of choice nowadays is propofol over ketamine, because propofol is a good drug for daycare surgery. So, especially in children who does not tolerate IV, can be given intramuscular ketamine. It has tendency to raise ICP, so it is preferably avoided if in case there is a space occupying lesion in brain or there is raised ICT. Just because it causes sympathetic stimulation and raises cardiac workload, heart rate and blood pressure, it is avoided in ischemic heart disease. It has a tendency to raise intraocular pressure so that blinding can occur in ophthalmic injuries, so it is to be avoided. Pheochromocytoma, hypertensive agents and hyperthyroidism, these patients have tendency of sympathetic stimulation, so preferable to avoid ketamine. Now talking about propofol, it is a drug which is in action these days, limelight these days, for its faster onset, faster recovery and clear-headed recovery. So it is a preferred agent for daycare surgery. It contains eglacetin, soybean oil, glycerol. These things have tendency for bacterial infection. It has pain. It causes pain on injection, on intravenous injection. Again, as we all know, it is in white color and a preferred agent for daycare surgery. It acts on GABA receptors, preferably on A-type receptors. Its induction dose is 1 to 1.5 milligram per kg. It can be used for maintenance, sedation. It has anti-emetic property too. Again, it has short duration of action. So if you need to put on maintenance dose, you have to put it on infusion. It also has anti-emetic and anti-pruritic activity. There are chances of bradycardia due to superimposed parasympathetic activity. There is chances of risk of infection, pain on injection, allergic reaction and an abuse potential. When propofol is given for a long period of hours, for more than 24 hours of more than 75 mics per kg per minute, it can lead to cardiac arrhythmias, tachycardia or metabolic acidosis. So this is to be taken care of. Propofol is a prodrug of propofol. It is FDA approved recently. In its property, it does not cause pain on injection or does not cause hyperlipidemia or less chances of bacterial infection just because it's preservative free. But again, it has a tendency of myoclonus. Let's talk about etomidate. So etomidate, again, it is a fat emulsion, so it causes pain on injection. It acts through GABA receptors. It can be used for induction, maintenance, sedation, and it has a duration of 5 to 8 minutes. Talking about etomidate, it is very cardiovascular stable, especially in the cardiac compromised patient. You can give etomidate because it has minimal action on heart rate, blood pressure and cardiac workload. It causes minimal respiratory depression and there is no histamine release. So taking in consideration of these things, it is a very well preferred drug for cardiorespiratory compromise. Also, it is a cerebroprotective effect, but again it has properties of myoclonus, but it has a drawback, that is of adrenocortical suppression. So patients with adrenocortical suppression, it is better to avoid etomidate. It has a tendency for nausea, vomiting and myoclonus, and it is not an analgesic. So we will need to have a good analgesic along with etomidate. Okay, so it can also inhibit platelet function. Again, it is an indicated drug for cardiorespiratory compromise, reactive airway disease, short duration sedation, say in ICU, or rapid sequence intubation in emergency conditions, it is a preferred choice. Again, it is relatively contraindicated in adrenocortical insufficiency, and research is going on these days regarding its use in adrenocortical insufficiency. And it has an epileptogenic tendency, so preferred to avoid in known case of epilepsy. Talking about benzodiazepines, they can be used as a sole induction agent or they can be used as an additive to other induction agents, especially with ketamine, ketamine. When you give benzodiazepines with ketamine, chances of emergence delirium from ketamine is very less. And again, it is used in sedation for radiological procedures, in ICU sedation, for endoscopy procedures. Preferably, it is avoided in pregnant patients to avoid teratogenic effect, especially the diazepam. And it can cause dependence and respiratory depressions. Now, these was about intravenous anesthetic agents. Now, let's discuss about MCQs. You can give your thought on these particular questions to just have a brief or revision. Now, you can guess which of the following agent is used to produce a street fit person following surgery. In sense, if you want a person to go and work directly at office the next day, what can be the preferred drug? Yes, and the one which is can be used among these four is propofol, because it is a preferred drug for daycare surgery where you have clear-headed recovery. Another question is, if thiopental sodium accidentally injected into an artery, the first symptom is? Yes, so it's preferably avoided to get intra-arterial injection. It's the first symptom will be pain. Okay, and the first sign will be redness. All are true about propofol except pleasant sedation and recovery. Yes, it is true. Safe in porphyria. Porphyria, the agent to be avoided is thiopental sodium. Antiemetic, yes, propofol has antiemetic property. Cardiac stimulant, no, propofol is not cardiac stimulant. It does not decreases or increases heart rate or blood pressure. It does suppress the airway reflexes. Talking about induction agent that may cause adrenocortical suppression is, yes, it's a etomidate. Etomidate causes adrenal cortical suppression. Ketamine belongs to which of the following group of drug? So, ketamine is a phencyclidine group. Which one of the common side effects is seen with fentanyl? Yes, fentanyl is an opioid. It can cause chest wall rigidity. Maximum analgesic is found with? Propofol has no analgesic action. Thiopental is antanalgesic. So, the answer here is ketamine. Now, what causes pain during injection? Which drug among these does not cause pain during injection is? It's? Yes, propofol and etomidate causes pain during injection because of lipid emulsion. Thiopental has some pain. Ketamine here does not causes pain during injection. It has an analgesic effect after IV injection. So, this was about intravenous and inhalation anesthetic agent. Thank you.